Hi, who will be speaking about compositional programming and testing of dynamic distributed systems. Welcome.
All right. Thanks everyone for coming. Okay, so distributed systems, most of the systems across domain these days are built as distributed systems in some form. And in the context of this talk, I'll be talking about distributed systems which are built on top of actor model of computation. And what I mean by that is a system consists of concurrently executing processes. Processes communicate with each other by sending messages asynchronously. There is no notion of shared memory. Processes can be created dynamically, as well as the communication topology between these actors or processes changes dynamically. And what I mean by that is that in actor model of computation, an actor sends a message to another actor by sending the using the reference to the actor. And this reference can be sent as a payload in messages. So as the program or the system evolves, the communication topology evolves dynamically. And this is the dynamism which is really required in building distributed systems, and that's what I really mean by dynamic distributed systems. And building this kind of systems is hard because you have to take into account concurrency, failures, and non-determinism in the environment. And in general, when you are building real-world distributed systems, your system is not a standalone single monolithic system. It would be consist of compositions of multiple protocols talking together to ensure the correctness properties of the system. So you have to make sure that you handle complex interactions as well. And what you need for this is a programming framework that allows you to address these challenges, right? And to that end, we have been working on this programming language called P, which is a high-level state machine-based programming language for writing safe event-driven programs, where in this case, instead of actors, we provide syntactic sugar to the programmer so that they can write the protocol as a state machine, and then the program is a collection of communicating state machines. And the whole idea is that we want to unify modeling, programming, and verification or testing into a single activity. So we provide a back-end systematic testing engine, which is built on top of model checking as well as symbolic execution engine to testing, as well as we generate code so that you can deploy it across platforms. And we have been using it inside Microsoft as well as in academia for building systems across domains like device drivers, distributed systems, and more recently, robotic applications. But one problem that we faced when we were trying to use this framework for building this kind of application was scalability of the back-end systematic testing approach. And in this talk, I'll talk about how we address that challenge by coming up with compositional approaches for decomposing the complex testing problem. Okay? So let's consider the example. Let's say I want to build a fault-tolerant distributed service, in this case, a transaction commit service, which is built using a two-phase commit protocol, which is a very famous protocol to perform transactional commits, right? And in general, the two-phase commit protocol doesn't really give you any fault tolerance guarantees. For example, if the coordinator or the participant fails, then you do not have progress guarantee. So the solution is to run it on top of a state machine replication protocol. The state machine replication protocol is a protocol that gives you fault tolerance by using log replication, and it may be implemented by either using multi-paxis protocol, which is a famous protocol, or a chain replication protocol. The point I wanted to make out of this slide was that even for building a very simple two-phase commit protocol and making it fault tolerant, it involves building a software stack that consists of many complex protocols that interact with each other to give you that guarantee. All right? And hence, testing the system is equally hard. So the most popular approach for testing the system is random testing, tools like Jepsen, QuickCheck, or you can do search prioritization and so on. But the problem obviously is that if you're considering a complex system like this, there is combinatorial explosion and you do not get very good coverage, adequate coverage that you really need, right? And essentially what these tools really do is they create a monolithic instance of the system and then they introduce various types of failures like maybe message loss or node failure, network partition and so on, right? But these techniques do not really scale because they are considering the entire system as a whole, right? And monolithic testing does not really scale. Another problem, apart from scalability with monolithic approach, is that you do not get reuse of systematic testing. What I mean by no reuse of systematic testing is that, for example, at some point, the developers want to replace the multi-paxos-based SMR protocol with chain replication-based SMR protocol. Now, you have to do the entire monolithic testing again because you are doing monolithic testing. What is the solution? If you are from formal methods or from software engineering, you know the solution is to do compositional reasoning. The solution is to use abstractions for decomposition, right? And this is not a novel technique. If you are doing testing, you call it mocking sometimes, right? The idea is You will test the two-phase commit protocol in isolation by mocking everything else that it interacts with. So for example, in this case, an abstraction of the SMR protocol. You will test the multiple access protocol by using an abstraction of the most abstract client, right? And show that or test or prove that they, in isolation, satisfy the atomicity property, right? And you hear there you are using abstractions to do testing in isolation for these components. Does this really help in the context, or for example, does it really help in the context of distributed systems? We conducted an experiment. I'm jumping to show you the results so that to convince you that it is effective. The experiment that we conducted was that on the x-axis are the traces in the linearizability or the SMR abstraction. On the y-axis are the number of executions that map onto the same trace in the linearizability abstraction. There are two points that I would like to make. The first one is that there are approximately 9,000 executions in the chain replication implementation that map to the same behavior in linearizability abstraction. What this has implication is that when you are testing in the two-phase commit protocol with the multi-access protocol, there are 9,000 executions that would trigger the same behavior in two-phase commit protocol, right? And that won't happen when you are doing it using the abstraction of the linearizability abstraction. Okay, that's point number one. Point number two is you can see the skewness that is there in the behavior. So if you use a random testing approach, it may be prioritized, it may be a systematic exploration, but in most cases, you would end up exploring a lot of behaviors there, and abstraction helps you to remove this skewness, okay? Does it work in practice? Yes, it works in practice, because both in terms of finding bugs faster. So these are bugs in our own implementation, but what we found was that there are many a times when compositional approaches finds bug with monolithic approach didn't even find after running for 10 hours. And in terms of coverage amplification, we have a backend for which does symbolic execution of P programs. And even there, we were in fact able to finish exploring the entire software stack in 1.3 hours, but we could not do it in 10 hours. And this is obvious because of this graph, right? Okay. So where are we? We are here where we know that abstraction-based decomposition can really help in terms of scaling in the test coverage or finding bugs faster. But is that enough? It's not enough. It's not enough because what might happen is that you make an under-approximating abstraction and you might miss certain bugs, right? And that's not good. What you would like to do there is you would like to have a way in which you can ensure that the abstractions that you actually used during testing are sound abstractions. So there has to be a way in which you can do this refinement check that all possible behaviors in my implementation were actually captured by the abstractions that I used during abstraction-based testing. Okay, that's point number one. This is good because this is enough for you to conclude that this check is sound in isolation. But that's not the goal of the entire thing. What you would really like is that to conclude that if I did these four checks, then it's enough for me to conclude that when I actually compose my system together, it will satisfy the atomicity condition. Okay? And that's where you would need the theory of compositional refinement to come up with this conclusion. And this is nothing new. In hardware community, in hardware verification, people have extensively built tools like Mocha from Rajiv Alur and Tom Henzinger, SMV from Ken McMillan, IO Automaton, and so on. They give you theory for pulling all this off. And the entire theory is based on four fundamental things that you need. Number one, you would have to define a notion of a module, which you would use as the unit of composition or doing analysis in isolation. A notion of a module that you can compose to build larger systems as well as do analysis of them in isolation. That's number one. Number two, you would need some module constructors like composition and so on so that you can compose modules and keep building larger complex systems. Number three, you have to define a notion of a refinement between two modules so that you can check whether a module refines another module. Right? And finally, you need a way in which you can substitute one module by another without really changing the code inside the two-phase commit protocol, because that's what would make it practically usable to substitute one thing by another, substitute the abstraction by implementation, and so on. All right? And if you can provide these four things, then you can enable a compositional analysis of your system. And what is challenging in our context is that in hardware it was fine, but for actor model of computation, you have dynamism. You have dynamism in the form of processes being created dynamically and communication topology being dynamic. And the contribution of our work is to come up with a compositional refinement theory for actor programs in the presence of all this dynamism, which was not there in the older work. We implemented it on top of this practical programming language P, and we found that it really helps in coverage amplification, as I showed, and also the performance is comparable to the open source equivalents. All right? So what is the roadmap? And if you understand this slide, and I think the rest of the things you can not ignore, but this is the main thing. So what we want is we want to start from a distributed system which is a collection of P state machines, and we would like to do modular reasoning of this. What I mean by modular reasoning is assume guarantee style reasoning, and the first theorem here is the circular assume guarantee reasoning, which states that if I want to check that my system, which is a composition of P1 composed with P2, refines Q1 composed with Q2, where Q1 is a specification of the component P1, and Q2 is the specification of the component P2. And if I want to do this, then it's enough to do this decomposed check in isolation. And notice that this is similar to what we were doing with respect to two-phase commit and the SMR protocol. So if you have this theorem, then you can do compositional reasoning. The other one is just saying that that composition is monotonic with respect to trace inclusion. All right, so we want to go from here to here. The first thing is we had to do certain extensions to the actor model of computation to make it amenable to compositional reasoning. Once we did that, we have to define a notion of a module so that you can compose modules and analyze modules in isolation. You have to define module constructors. And this theorem can be proved if you can prove a fundamental theorem that composition is language intersection. What I mean is that composition of two modules, the traces in that composed module is basically a trace of belongs to the trace of each of the component module. And for doing this, we had to define a notion of a well-formed module and then define the semantics of the module so that you can have composition as intersection. All right, so that's the roadmap. So the first one, what are the extensions that we had to make to the P program? So let's take the example of a client-server module. So this is it's fine if you ignore the syntax of the P program, but it consists of events which are used to communicate between machines, and machines have states, local variables, and entry functions, and so on. And the extension, the first extension that we had to do to actor model of computation is in actor model of computation, an actor can be created by using the concrete name of the actor. But in compositional reasoning, it's not good because at some point you might want to replace the server implementation with server abstraction, which would mean that you have to change this code. So for that, we added a notion of an interface. An interface is a symbolic name for the machine, and the linking between the creation of the interface to the machine happens separately. So this is the first extension. This is syntactical in terms of the extension. The second extension, we had to annotate the machines or actors with the set of actions or the visible actions that the actor is going to perform. Okay, this is also a syntactic change. The third change is a more semantic change. In actor model of computation, you can use the identifier of the actor to send arbitrary events to the actor. But that's not good from the point of view of compositional reasoning. So let's say I want to analyze the server impl in isolation. And then in that case, what are the events that the environment of the machine can send? And the assumption that we make is that it is only going to send the events that are there in the receive set of that machine. And hence, we want to ensure that even when you compose this machine with something else, this property should hold. And that's why we changed the semantics of send to say that using the identifier of a machine, you can send only those events to the machine that belong to its receive set. Otherwise, we drop it's an error. All right. So this is the three changes. If you do to your actor-based programming language, then the theory that is presented in the paper for module system can be adapted to any actor-based programming languages. All right. So what is a module? A module, in our case, is a collection of state is a mapping from interface to the machine. And this is where the linking from the interface to the machine happens. So in a composed module, when the client module it creates the IF server to client interface that leads to the creation of system server impl. And you can do substitution very easily now because you could just say that in this case, the creation of iServer to client maps to a server abstraction. And you can now, in this case, you have substituted the server impl with server abstraction. And this is enough to enable abstraction-based decomposition of your system. So now you can, in P, you can write these two checks, which are automatically discharged by the backend engine to do decomposition of the original monolithic problem. So we are at a point where you can do abstraction-based decomposition. But we would like to do refinement and then conclude that actually this is enough to prove properties about the entire system. All right. So for that, we need a notion of a module, its traces, and its refinement. Right? a module syntactically is this. What does it mean semantically? Semantically, it is an asynchronous composition of its component machines. And its visible actions are events its visible actions are the union of the visible actions of its component machines. So for example, the events that are being sent are the unions of the send events of the component machines and so on. And also for assume guarantee reasoning, it's very important to consider a module as an open system where the environment can send it events and it responds using output. And in this case, the input from the environment is basically the events that it, for example, in the case of events, is the events that the module can receive, removing the events that actually are sent by the module. I'm skipping the operational semantics, but it's there in the paper, but you can think of it as the trace as being a sequence of visible actions of the module, and our traces are detailed enough to capture the dynamism in the system, like creation of interfaces and payload and so on, and refinement is pure trace containment based. And the reason we did this choice was we wanted to enable refinement being a simple matching operation without being really complicated, because in the end, we wanted to leverage the back-end systematic testing engine like model checking and symbolic execution to do this. And having this simple refinement check can really be pulled off by using any existing testing approaches. All right, so we are here. And in the interest of time, I'll skip this part. The composition, the well-formedness for module composition and to ensure that it actually leads to composition being intersection is a well-studied problem, and you just need to ensure that the outputs are disjoint. But things get a bit more complicated in the case of hiding events. You might want, hiding events is similar to in Pi calculus making certain channels private, certain visible actions private. All right, and when you would like to do this, you would like to do this, for example, when to make composition flexible. Note that we wanted output disjointness, so to make composition flexible, you want to make some events private. And this adds private events to the module. And the challenge with respect to hiding in dynamic systems like actor model of computation is you would like to ensure that when you are doing testing or analysis of a module in isolation, there is never a possibility that a module that is a machine outside the module sends a private event to this module. And this is challenging in the case of dynamism, because now you have to ensure that an identifier using which a machine can send a private event to this module should not leak outside the module. Right, and this is more, so we came up with this, we reused the technique of capability-based access control to ensure that a machine identifier or an actor reference using which you can send private events does not leak outside the module. And that's the type system, we came up with this type system, and it's mentioned in the paper, it's there in the paper. That's one of the challenges that we had to pull off to enable compositional refinement for actor programs. Yes, and this is the slide that I actually am pretty proud of, and this is, so for example, doing integration testing of distributed systems is pretty hard. And what we enabled is now the programmer can write this kind of simple checks as composition of abstraction with implementation and so on. And just writing these checks, the backend automatically does compositional reasoning. It also tells the programmer that, oh, you used abstraction while doing decomposition, but you failed to write this refinement check, and hence your analysis is not sound. So just by writing these things, pulling components together and so on, and we can do integration testing of distributed systems. Performance is comparable. We compared it against an EPAXOS open source implementation in Go, and it's good. Conclusion, we came up with this, and because I wanted to end with this final slide, which is that building distributed systems is difficult and unpleasant, but if you really put your brains to come up with this programming language techniques and automated reasoning, you can make it possible. And the entire code along with it is available open source in P as under MIT license, so please use it and so on. And we use it for building the robotics application, so it is applicable across domains. Yeah, thanks.
Let me remind you that we're using Slido for questions as well as live questions, so if you want to ask a question, anonymously, privately, sli.do, and then oopsla 18 will get you in here. But meanwhile, we're happy to answer live questions.
Hi. I always liked P, so I very much like the follow-on work. Now that we're in a distributed context, I wondered if you had any thoughts about ways to more automatically incorporate replication into the framework here, as opposed to just having single actors.
So replication can be done. I mean, you would have to write. So we wrote the entire multipaxis protocol using this. So yes, I mean, if you want to have fault tolerance for an actor, in our case, at least, yes, you have to. But there are efforts inside where they are coming up with this library so that you can automatically get replication for actors. But yeah, that was not the point here. That answer. Okay.
Thanks.
Other questions?
Yeah, very cool work. So I'm just wondering about the notion of refinement, that most of this message passing system have basically a notion of alternating refinement, which is quite a bit more complex from just trace inclusion. So I don't know if you can comment a bit more on that.
Yes, so in our case, the notion of refinement is completely trace containment based. And we don't really consider, so we made sure that, so one challenge there is you have to ensure that your traces are detailed enough so that you capture the dynamism in the system. And once you have, so we did capture the notion of creation of actors, because that's one dynamism, and then you made sure that the identifiers that are being sent across are captured in the trace. And then the check was pretty easy, just to make sure that the traces are equally matched to the abstraction trace. And we did this because we wanted to use the backend and testing engine, which does enumeration-based exploration. So that's why trace containment-based refinement was the best approach for us.